Hello and welcome to the forum. I'm Michael Fontroy. This is a continuation of our conversation with the Reverend Walter Fontroy as he reflects on 50 years in public life. In our last discussion, we covered his upbringing in segregated Washington, D.C., and his involvement in the civil rights movement in the 1960s. I want to pick up the conversation in the year 1968. Reverend Martin Luther King is killed that year. Senator Bobby Kennedy is killed that year. And in November of that year, Richard Nixon is elected president. 68 was a tumultuous year in this country. What was it like for you being right there in it all?
Well, it was a watershed point of departure for me. I'll never forget on the morning of April the 5th, 1968, in the White House. And there I was in shock with Hubert Humphrey, the vice president, with Thurgood Marshall, and with several of the leaders from around the country who were there, just befuddled. And it was significant that I was there with Humphrey, because when Dr. King asked me to be his representative to the leadership of the House and Senate and the presidents at that time, Hubert Humphrey became my sort of role model in terms of a mentor. He had gave me two things that followed me throughout my post King assassination years. The first was a quote that he had about government. He said, "The role of government is to care for those in the dawn of life, the children, those in the shadows of life, the poor, the disadvantaged, the handicapped, and those in the twilight of life, the elderly." And it tracked so well with what we in our movement and in our religious orientation understood, and that is, our concern has to be for the least of these. And it tracked to Martin King's devotion to the American dream and my devotion to the Founding Fathers, who were very wise. They, in the preamble to the Constitution, said, "We, the people of the United States, in order to perform a more perfect union, to establish justice, to provide for the general welfare, and you can't have domestic tranquility unless you provide for the general welfare," I understood. Hubert Humphrey understood that better than any politician I'd come in contact with at the time. He knew the importance of what Dr. King and I looked for: people who were technically competent and spiritually mature. Technically competent people understand that everybody of every race, creed, and color needs to have access to five things: income, education, healthcare, housing, and justice. And that if you are spiritually mature, you're going to get them those five things in self-defense. So tracking with our religious upbringing, we said, live for the sake of others and love your neighbor in self-defense. People ought to understand that you ought to want your neighbor to have his own income, because if he doesn't, he's going to come for yours. That your neighbor needs education, because if he doesn't, he will ruin your schools that your children attend. And that your neighbor needs health care, because if cholera breaks out, it's an equal opportunity destroyer. And you need shelter from the elements. You need housing. And if your neighbor doesn't have a house, guess whose house he'll break into in the winter? And above all, your neighbor needs justice, because if he doesn't have it, you as his neighbor are going to feel the weight of his anger and hostility, the pain of being unjustly treated. That, for me, pointed the way to what Humphrey called the role of government, to make sure that everybody gets enough of those five things, not to have chaos, to make sure that you have general welfare as the only means by which you can achieve what I call domestic tranquility. So it marked all that I did after his death, and after I became the first of his movement elected to the Congress. I sought ways of doing in the Congress what we had attempted to do in our movement, and that is to love your neighbor and to love the country.
Now, let me drill in a little bit on these years between 1968, when King is assassinated, in 1971, when you're elected to Congress. 7 months after King is assassinated, Richard Nixon, who has a different orientation than Hubert Humphrey and Lyndon Johnson, is elected president. What did Nixon's election say about the country, and what did Nixon's election mean for the movement?
Well, first of all, it frightened me. It frightened me because before 68 was over, I could look back over 7 years and see that we had lost four of the brightest, most courageous young men the nation had produced. John F. Kennedy on November 22nd, 1963. Malcolm X on February the 25th, 1965. Martin Luther King on April the 4th, 68. And 2 months to the almost a day, Robert Kennedy. All of whom were technically competent and spiritually mature and wanted the American dream for all of its citizens. That was devastating. And when Humphrey lost to Nixon, and we could see a throwback to those who had frightened us in 64 by saying extremism in defense of liberty is a virtue. We were terribly worried. Not as worried as I am now, because I know more, mm-hmm. and the dangers are greater today than they were then. But we were worried.
Now, you mentioned a moment ago that you were the first of the movement to be elected to Congress. Mm-hmm. It's 1971. Why did you decide to run?
Well, as I said, we understood that politics is a process of determining who gets how much of what, when, and where in five areas. Mm-hmm. We understood why they beat Cheney, Swearinger, Goodman to death, why they gunned down Viola Lewitsu on Highway 80 after that march that we organized for Dr. King in 65. We understand why they beat Cheney, Swearinger, Goodman to death in Meridian, Mississippi, because they didn't want us to vote. Because as I told you last time, every time a group of politicians sits down to make decisions, they're deciding five things. Who's going to get the money out of this? Whose children are going to get quality education? Who's going to get health care? Who's going to get housing? And who's going to get justice? And we understood why people of African descent in this country got the least income, education, health care, housing, and justice, because we were not allowed to vote. They didn't want us to vote. I must say this. November the 2nd, 2010, was a throwback for me to November the 2nd, 1885, when there was an election. Prior to the election, after the 14th Amendment, we elected six Southern governors who were black and had 16 members of the Senate from the South black because our people couldn't vote. And the reaction to it was brutal. That year, they intimidated black voters going to the polls to expand their command and control over the instruments of government. And the next year, the Tilden-Hayes deal was done, which withdrew the federal troops from the South and left the masses of black voters at the mercy of Klansmen. And as a consequence, we were driven from the politics of the South. I'll never forget Lew Stokes when we formed the Congressional Black Caucus, 13 of us. Said, well, Hiram Jones was right when he said, we will rise like a phoenix again. And so we were the phoenix rising after they had driven everyone out and denied us that right. So I got into politics because I understood that if you're going to declare good news to the poor, bind up the brokenhearted and set at liberty them that are bound, you'd better get involved in politics because they decide who gets how much of what, when, and where.
You mentioned the CBC, founded in 1971. You were one of the founding members of that organization. Take us back to that time. You know, how was the CBC sort of received publicly by other members of Congress, by the media? I mean, was it seen as a threat or was it seen as something other than that?
Well, I think it was seen as a relief on the part of people who love America, because it was embarrassing with our touting democracy abroad and people here not enjoying it. It was embarrassing. We had fought two world wars. And thousands of black young men had died defending a democracy that they didn't enjoy. Huh? So they had to feel guilty. Any white person who was out there fighting and seeing black soldiers die with them and their friends had to feel guilty. And quite frankly, there was relief that we were there. When we got into serious politics, however, there was great concern. And the concern was that we were now riding on the votes of 2 million new black voters from the South. They had become the marginal vote in 77 congressional districts of the South. I understood that because that had been my role throughout the 60s, to understand the arithmetic of black political power. In fact, I'd run for the office on the thesis that we would master the arithmetic of black political power in coalition with whites and others of goodwill who wanted to spread four or five things to the people because they were losing the quality of life.
So you're elected in 1971, and the big issue within the District of Columbia at that time was home rule.
Yes.
You know, there's a curious case in American democracy as it relates to the District of Columbia. Many people around the country don't know that there are limitations on the access to the practice of politics, and you wanted to move in a new direction and get home rule for the District of Columbia. Take us through that.
Well, it was a 20-year journey, more than 20 years for me, to be elected to the Congress, because when I was 13, I got the idea that the only way we're going to get free to vote in the District of Columbia is for black people across the South to get their vote, and then in coalition with whites and Hispanics and others of goodwill, we could get our voting rights in the District of Columbia. I had gone through elementary school and junior high school furious about the fact that we were singing, "Oh, beautiful for spacious skies and for amber waves of grain, and this is my country and our country," and we couldn't vote. So I had that in my mind from the time Martin asked me to help him. And at that point, I had kept the names of 100,000 people that we had organized to come to Washington for the march and other things that I had been able to do as the Washington Bureau director. And as a member of Congress, I had to frank. As you could, you put your name on a piece of paper, send it over to the government printed office, and they send you envelopes with your signature on it, and went free. I became the Frank King of Capitol Hill because the first thing I did was to run for president. We had strategized that what we needed to do was to run for president and get my colleagues to run favorite son candidacies and then combine the delegates that we could muster there. And we realized that then we would have the marginal vote. That is, we would have the sufficient votes to make sure that whoever got to be the nominee had to come by us. And guess what? It happened. What happened was we had a Gary convention. I had the great privilege of being chair of the Issues Committee. And a young man by the name of
Was that Dick Hatcher?
No, Dick was the elected mayor.
Yeah.
But Ron Walters, mm-hmm. from Howard University's School of Political Science, was the person that Charlie Diggs assigned to me to work out our platform. We worked out a platform that was just beautiful. It went through five things. What are you going to do to generate income for us? Education, healthcare, housing, and justice in terms of specific measures. And we put together the agenda out of Gary, and lo and behold, by June, we had amassed 96 delegates who were not on anybody's slate, but who were waiting to see who would be the best to emerge, who would handle our agenda. And it so happened that Humphrey didn't have enough votes on the first ballot, McGovern didn't have enough votes, Muskie didn't have enough votes, and whoever got our votes would be the nominee of the party. And it was a joy of my life to see, having done neighborhood discussions of what we wanted in our agenda for D.C., just as I'd had people doing around the country, neighborhood discussions on what kind of policies they wanted that would generate for them income, education, healthcare, housing, and justice. We laid it on all four of them, and McGovern got the best exam, And we nominated him, and we became the marginal vote to make him the nominee of the party.
So you're elected in large measure to help move forward with D.C. Home Rule. The bill passes in 1973, goes into effect in January of 1975 after elections in the fall of 74. Some people consider that the last of the civil rights bills that come through. Now, throughout the 70s and into the 80s, you're a member of the United States Congress, but you're still a civil rights activist at heart. And I want to fast forward to 1984, mm-hmm. Thanksgiving Eve. You get arrested. Mm-hmm. Why?
Well, two things. First of all, when you say civil rights, you're really talking about civil society. And the role of civil society, according to Humphrey and according to us, is that you spread those things among all the people, those in the dawn of life, the children who can't earn income and can't, you know, just get educated on their own, those in the shadows of life, those who fall through the cracks, and those who are elderly. And so it was just a continuation. I was happy to get to go from the streets to the suites to work this stuff out. And there came a time in 1984 when we had a president who not only believed that the poor have too much money, so we cut $280 billion of programs designed to meet the needs of the young, the old, the sick, and the poor, who believed the rich had too little money. So he took $750 billion of tax money and gave it to the top 2% income earners of the country on the thesis that they know what to do with it. They will reinvest it in new planet equipment and put the American people to work. Well, I was smart enough knowing what sin is the arrogance and self-seeking of man. I knew they would take those dollars and convert them to yen and marks and francs and rubles and invest them in cheap labor abroad. And they were sucking the jobs in the labor-intensive smokestack, auto, rubber, steel, and textile industries out of this country. So the shirts and ties and shoes and socks that used to be made in North and South Carolina were now being made in Japan and Korea. Automobiles that were being made in Detroit were now being made in Japan and in Germany and elsewhere where you get people to work for less. So it was very disturbing. There came a time when this same president said that Bolter ain't heavy. He's our brother. Now, Bolter was the prime minister of South Africa who had really imposed a rigid form of slavery and segregation. We call it apartheid. See, before you can move from one town to another, we got to give you a passport. And you will work for $145 a month making steel. Well, I saw that as a link to George Wallace, because George Wallace had steel mills in Birmingham and in Bessemer that were closing down because the wealthy few were taking their money and investing it in South Africa and making steel to provide for ships being made in Mobile, a big shipbuilding area in Alabama, with steel imported from there. Before I knew it, George Wallace said, "Walter, you're going to be my, I'm going to give you, make you an honorary colonel in the Confederate Army if you can stop that." And so what we understood is that the Founding Fathers gave us two means of influencing public policy. One is to go to the polls and vote for people when elected, who would promise you that you'd spread some of those five things to them. But they realized that there might come a time when in a majority rule situation, the legitimate concern of any one citizen might not be addressed by that. And so they gave us all the First Amendment, which says that no state shall deny any citizen the right of peaceable assembly to petition the people for change in public policy. And so we were wise enough to recognize that, and I, because I'd come from it, that there's sometimes things you have to work out in the streets that can't be worked out in the suites. There's no way in the world we're going to, as popular as Reagan was, we're going to get sanctions against South Africa or a King Holiday Bill if we didn't prick the conscience of enough people. And so I did submit myself with Randall Robinson and Mary Frances Berry to the science of nonviolence. We peaceably assembled at the office of the distinguished ambassador from South Africa on South African territory in Washington, Ambassador Foray, and asked him for a change in public policy. I asked him because I'd already spoken to Mr. Bolter the year before, who told me, listen, boy, in the big ocean, the big fish always eat up little fish, and you're all a little fish. Well, now, you can kind of imagine, coming from 7th and T, what I wanted to say to him, but I couldn't because I was a minister and because I was a member of Congress. I said, that's all right. I'll see you later. We went back and got ourselves arrested on Thanksgiving Eve, 2 hours before prime time, when ABC and NBC and CBS had nothing much to report but turkeys. And after discussion with him, and he refused to call Mr. Bolter and tell him to dismantle apartheid forthwith, we said we're going to sit in this office. And he took me in handcuffs out at 5 o'clock in the afternoon at a time when Tom Brokaw, Peter Jennings, Dan Rather, and Bernard Shaw had been alerted that on a slow day, if you had a camera up on Massachusetts Avenue, you might see something. Do you know they took me out in handcuffs, my shirt, my tie taken off because they thought I might strangle myself, you know? And that evening, while everybody's home, announcement, Congressman arrested in Washington. Everybody stopped saying, was it our congressman? Because we don't trust him. And then, because it was a slow day the next day, Thanksgiving, everybody's home. Every half hour and a half hour, I was coming out into the living rooms. And people were saying, what is this? I said, who is that? I said, some old colored congressman. So, oh, well, they always didn't arrest it. But they got tired. They interrupted every time they had a break from the football game or something. Congressman coming out. And on something called apartheid. Well, then the next day, Charlie Rangel and Don Edwards, a congressman from California, white congressman from California, came there and said, arrest me too. And then the next day, the other members came down. Before we knew it, we had a whole year. People lined up, I want to get arrested, to make sure that people, that two things happened. That we raised public consciousness to the need for this change, and that we pricked the conscience of enough people that they who can vote will say, enough is enough. Do you know that within 1 year, within 2 years, we had two pieces of legislation that Reagan had sworn he wasn't going to sign? First of all, we had a sanctions against his boys in South Africa, who were his brothers, he told us. And secondly, and most important, we had a holiday for the singularly most important man with the most important message for the most violent century in the history of mankind, Martin Luther King Jr. And it was not by accident, because we saw in the future what has now happened. Do you know that Martin King's birthday is celebrated in 108 nations around this nation, around the country, around the world? And that little children, over the last 17 years, we've had this celebration of nonviolence and the American dream and loving one another unconditionally and fighting injustice. 17 years from that, later, young people all over the world identified with a Barack Obama, who was what Martin Luther King Jr. saw from the mountaintop way back in 1968, when he said, I've been to the mountain. I'm not going to get there with you. But we as a people will get there, not just black people, but all of us who are concerned about civil society and caring for one another.
So that's 1986. That's 1984 when you get arrested. The two bills you just referenced are enacted shortly thereafter. And 1990, you leave Congress.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So you're in Congress for 20 years. Mm-hmm. What's the single most important thing you learned while in Congress?
I learned that the key to the American dream is to have leadership that is technically competent, that understands that everybody needs these five things. And if you don't get it, you're going to have chaos. And the other thing I learned is what we confirmed, is that you ought to love your neighbor. You ought to try to get your neighbor these five things in self-defense. Because if they don't make it, they're going to take it. And you can't have domestic tranquility unless you have general welfare, as the founding fathers told us.
Now, I want to compare what's going on now with what was going on when you were in Congress in this one area, and that is partisanship. Mm-hmm. You know, one of the continuing narratives in contemporary Congress is how partisan the place is and how you can't get anything done. How do you compare then to now in terms of partisanship?
There are only two kinds of public policy processes. One is top-down. Give it to the wealthy, and they will take care of those. And the other is bottom-up. give it to the those who need it in terms of relief, and they will buy and increase the wealth of the wealthy. And the tendency is in the Republican Party to have more who are conservative, who want to conserve things the way they are, and who don't want to spread it, who want it all themselves. And in the Democratic Party, you have those who more lean more toward what you call redistributing the wealth of the nation so that everybody has a minimum amount of income, education, health care, housing, and justice, and you can have some domestic tranquility. So that it doesn't matter to me whether you're Democrat, Republican, black, white, red, brown, yellow. You've got to be technically competent and understand that there's going to be no peace unless government is of the people. Government not of the corporations, of the kings and queens of England, huh, who came and took this land and began to, and renamed it. Virginia was, that was a power town, but they said, this is a queen's land, and Mary's land, and this is New Hampshire. That kind of understanding has got to be tempered with the question, what good is a politician unless he does three things? He does justly, loves mercy, and walks humbly, to understand that we need one another. Now that's for some people Pollyanna religious stuff. The fact is that unless you have that, you're going to have chaos, because poverty and injustice drives people insane. You've got to be stone crazy to put a bomb on yourself and say, I'm going to fix all these other people here now. I'm going to get them. I mean, it's just, but that's what happens when you have government of the corporations, by the corporations, and for the corporations. The business of government is not business. The business of government is people, and people who, when they come to understand the what I call loving neighbor and self-defense, will tranquilize things and make sure everybody has enough not to go after other people. That being the case, I have enjoyed then, and now, more painfully, the fact that the final and most important lesson I've learned is what Benjamin Disraeli taught. He said, great nations rise and fall. They go from bondage to spiritual strength, and from spiritual strength to courage, and from courage to liberty. Give me liberty or give me death. And from liberty to abundance, and then in selfishness. They go from abundance to selfishness, and then to complacency, and then to apathy, and then back to dependence, and back to bondage. We've got to break this cycle, and I think people of goodwill who understood what Martin Luther King Jr. was saying, either we learn to live together as brothers and sisters beyond race, creed, and color, or we're going to perish together as fools.
Well, thank you very much for that. And on that note, we're going to hit the pause button and maybe come back and do it again at some point. Thank you all very much for watching. Please tell your friends about the forum. Until next time.